You're probably familiar with the creeping sensation you get when you think you're being watched. Without explanation, you're convinced that someone is observing your every move, even if there is no evidence to suggest it. It's a sense, a gut feeling, an unnerving awareness that you can't determine, but nevertheless, it's there. For some, this is nothing more than a paranoia which eventually fades away. But for others, it can be far more sinister, with more than just a suspicion that someone has them in their sights. This is the Sinister Stalking of Dorothy Jane Scott. Dorothy Jane Scott, a 32-year-old single mother, lived with her 4-year-old son, Shanti, also known as Sean, at her aunt's house in Stanton, California. She worked as a secretary for Swinger's Psych Shop and Custom John's Head Shop, two businesses which were jointly owned in Anaheim and previously co-owned by her father, Jacob Scott. The two buildings were conjoined, allowing Dorothy to work in a back office room for both businesses, rarely engaging with customers of either store. These shops sold recreational drugs, paraphernalia, and other such items, which were very popular at the time for those who were part of the hippie cultural movement sweeping the US. Dorothy's character was reported as being quite the opposite to her place of work, with one friend describing her being as dull as a phone book, as she would hardly socialise outside of long working hours, rarely dated, and was devoutly religious. Despite this, many people would go on to describe Dorothy as a hard-working and kind-hearted person who would always have the best intention for the well-being of others. Dorothy's selfless and caring nature was respected by many, though there were other people in her world that didn't apply to the same morals.
On the evening of Wednesday the 28th of May, 1980, Dorothy dropped Sean off at her parents' home as she usually would, and headed into her place of work for an employee meeting. During this meeting, Dorothy noticed that her colleague, Conrad Bostron, began looking increasingly unwell, showing significant unrest and developing a deep red rash on his arm. Feeling concerned, Dorothy convinced Conrad that he needed medical attention, and insisted on escorting him to the hospital. Another colleague at the meeting, Pam Head, agreed to help, so they all got in Dorothy's car and left as soon as possible. Dorothy, who was driving her white 1973 Toyota station wagon, stopped at her parents' house along the journey. She quickly checked up on her son and informed her parents that she was heading to the UCI Medical Center. For some reason during this quick detour, Dorothy decided to change the black scarf she was wearing to a red one, before returning to the car and continuing along the journey. Once the group arrived at the ER, doctors quickly established that Conrad was suffering from the effects of a black widow spider bite and immediately rushed him for treatment. Whilst Conrad was being seen to, Dorothy and Pam waited in the hospital lobby together and passed the time with conversation and reading magazines. After a few hours, Conrad eventually re-emerged from the treatment room and was reunited with his two colleagues, who stayed together the entire time. At around 11 p.m, as Pam helped Conrad finish up some paperwork at the hospital reception, Dorothy informed the pair that to avoid Conrad overexerting himself and walking too far, she would bring the car around from its parking space to the entrance of the medical center. Conrad and Pam finished up a few minutes later, and after picking up his prescription, they made their way out of the hospital, expecting to see Dorothy waiting for them in a car. Dorothy, however, was nowhere to be seen, and the pair waited in the cold night with growing concern. To the relief of Pam and Conrad, Dorothy's car came speeding towards them. But that relief would soon turn to worry. The car was approaching at a considerable speed, with the headlights on full beam, blinding the awaiting passengers who were waving frantically to signal to stop. Before reaching the hospital entrance, it took a sharp right turn and sped out of the car park, with Pam and Conrad attempting to chase behind on foot. The car eventually disappeared into the night, with Pam and Conrad questioning what they had just witnessed. Their first thoughts were that perhaps Dorothy's son had an emergency, and that she had raced off urgently to get back to her parents. Pam and Conrad decided to stay at the hospital in the hope that Dorothy would return, but after a few hours they became increasingly worried, so alerted the UCI police. They initially saw no cause for concern, so Pam decided to phone Dorothy's parents to see if the theory was true, but Dorothy hadn't returned home for her son. Several hours later, the whereabouts of Dorothy became all the more alarming when her car was found abandoned and on fire, around 10 miles away, in a Santa Ana alleyway, with no sign of its driver.
Police immediately began searching for Dorothy, as her parents, Jacob and Vera Scott, began to grow desperately worried for her safety. The police initially informed the parents to remain tight-lipped to the press during the early days of her disappearance, as they felt it could jeopardise their efforts in finding a potential suspect in the case. They originally agreed, but this soon changed when Vera received a sinister phone call 1 week later. Upon answering her home phone, a mysterious male voice asked Vera, "Are you related to Dorothy Scott?" When Vera replied that she was, the voice said, "I've got her," before hanging up. With overwhelming fear setting in, Dorothy's father Jacob decided to take matters into his own hands and contacted the Santa Ana Register in the hopes that they could find information if they were to publish news of her disappearance. On the day the news was printed, a call from the same menacing voice came to the editor of the newspaper, Pat Riley. "I killed her," he said. "I killed Dorothy Scott. She was my love. I caught her cheating with another man. She denied having someone else. I killed her." It's not uncommon for people to call the press pretending to be a notorious killer, or a man on the run from the law. But Pat knew immediately that this man was genuine. The caller authenticated himself by providing details that nobody else could have known and that hadn't been printed, such as Dorothy wearing a red scarf that night, and that Conrad had suffered a spider bite. He claimed that Dorothy had called him that evening to tell him that she was at the UCI Medical Center. But Pam insisted that this couldn't have happened, as Dorothy never left her side other than to use the bathroom just before retrieving the car. These calls sent shivers down the spines of Dorothy's family, but it turned out that this wasn't the first time this man had tormented the Scots through the phone.
For months before her disappearance, Dorothy had begun receiving daily phone calls from an anonymous man while she was at work. These calls would range from professions of undying love to abhorrent insults and even death threats. Dorothy told a co-worker that this unknown man would describe events in great detail that were actually happening in her life to show that he was generally stalking her. She claimed that the voice sounded familiar, but did not know it well enough for her to identify who it could have been. As time went on, the calls began to become increasingly more sinister. One day whilst at work, Dorothy was told to check outside the shop for a gift that the caller had left for her. Upon exiting the building, Dorothy found a single dead rose lying neatly on her car windshield. During one of the more disturbing calls, Dorothy is quoted to have been told, "Okay, now you're going to come my way, and when I get you alone, I will cut you up into bits so no one will ever find you." Dorothy was understandably frightened by all of this, so much so that she began taking up karate lessons for self-defense, and even considered buying a gun at one point for protection. After learning of these past events and witnessing the calls to the press and her parents, the police became more and more convinced that the caller was the prime suspect and cause for Dorothy's disappearance.
The anonymous calls to the Scots residence continued to come in every single Wednesday, with the caller continuing to ask, "Is Dorothy there? I've got her," or simply explaining that he had killed her. The calls would always be during the day when Dorothy's mother Vera was home alone, with Jacob never being present to answer himself. The police captured the caller's voice on a recorder, but nobody recognised the tone, which was described as gruff and plainly disguised. Police were also unable to trace the calls, as the caller would never stay on the line long enough for a connection to be made, likely knowing that he was being tracked. Police began checking possible leads, and quickly ruled out the father of Dorothy's child, Dennis Terry, as a potential suspect. Dennis, who lived in Missouri, had actually called Jacob Scott on the night of Dorothy's disappearance, with Jacob ringing him back later that evening on his home phone, confirming he was nowhere near UCI Medical Center. Everyone at Dorothy's workplace was questioned twice over, and police checked her social circles to see if she potentially had any enemies, but they found little to nothing. The Scotts went as far as consulting two separate psychics for guidance on where Dorothy could be, with detectives even doing so themselves. Beginning to believe that she may have died, Dorothy's parents eventually offered to pay $2,500 to anyone with information as to her whereabouts or if they knew where her body was. The calls continued to torture Dorothy's parents every week on a Wednesday afternoon for 4 years, with the caller remaining unknown throughout the entire ordeal. In April 1984, however, for the first time, the phone rang the Scott's household at night. Since it wasn't during the day like usual, Jacob was at home, and this time was able to answer the call himself. The caller didn't speak a word down the line, and eventually hung up after a minute or two. At this point, the call stopped, with Jacob speculating that the caller probably assumed that new residents now lived in their house, so had decided to call it a day. Unfortunately, this wouldn't be the last time they would be harassed down the phone by the unknown man.
Around 3.5 months after the last call, on August 6th, 1984, at around 7:15 a.m, a construction worker named Jesse Lozer started his usual shift on site at Santa Ana Canyon Road, Anaheim. As his team began their shift digging into the ground, Jesse jokingly told his co-workers to watch out for dead bodies. Minutes later, Jesse himself happened upon skeletal remains and alerted the local police. When police assessed the scene, what they found left them scratching their heads, as the bones were not just those of a human skeleton, but also of a dog. It looked as though the canine bones had been placed on top of the human ones intentionally, perhaps to ward off other animals from encroaching on the remains. They were also slightly charred, which led police to believe that they had been there for at least 2 years due to the fact that brush fire swept across the site in the autumn of 1982. The human remains consisted of only a pelvis, an arm, two femurs, and a skull. There was also a turquoise ring found on the scene, as well as a watch that the time had stopped on 12:30 a.m. on May the 29th, 1980. What's significant about this time and date is that it was roughly 1 hour after Dorothy's car was seen speeding away from the hospital by Pan and Comrade. Vera was able to identify the ring belonged to her daughter, and a week later, dental records were positively matched to conclude it was the remains of Dorothy Jane Scott. Her cause of death was unknown, but the family were finally able to get some form of closure that Dorothy's fate had been determined. After the papers reported the news of Dorothy's discovery, the Scotts would once again be distressed by two more phone calls from the likely killer, asking simply, "Is Dorothy home?"
Police never came close to discovering who had stalked, kidnapped, and killed Dorothy Jane Scott, with both her parents passing away, not knowing what happened to their beloved daughter. There have been many theories since on who could have potentially been her killer, but none of these are substantiated by any proof and are mere speculation. During her memorial service, Dorothy's brother Jim Scott gave an emotional speech highlighting the memories he had of his kind-hearted and selfless sister. Gesturing towards a bank of flowers, Jim proclaimed, "Dorothy lives. Maybe not in that body, but she lives." In cases such as these, it's sometimes easy to forget the lives that people had lived prior to their death. Jim's message resonates not just to Dorothy, but to all victims whose lives have been unjustly cut short at the hands of others. It's important that, when remembering such tragic cases, we also remember the innocent lives behind the story, to help ensure that they may live on forever. Thanks everyone for watching this video. I just want to say a massive shout out to Disasterthon for helping me create this video and for telling this story. If you're really interested in learning about lesser known disasters throughout the world, go visit his channel. He makes amazing videos. I'll put a link in the description here just so you can check that out. And I just want to say also a massive thank you to all of my subscribers. I've recently just made 1,000 subscribers on YouTube, so it feels like a massive milestone for me. I just want to thank you all for sticking around and watching my videos. As always, if you have a case or a story that you want me to cover, feel free to get in touch with me. I have an email on my YouTube page, or you can just put a comment in this video below. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you on the next video.